Rita Hayworth and Shawshank Redemption. By Stephen King. You're not going to tell me that you had time to set up a false identity while the bulls were sweating you. No, my friend Jim was the one who set up the identity. The major pieces of identification were in his hand by spring of 1950. He must have been a pretty close friend. I was not sure how much of this I believed. A little, a lot, or none. But the day was warm and the sun was out, and it was one hell of a good story. All of that's 100% illegal. Setting up false identity like that. He was a close friend. We were in the war together. France, Germany, the occupation. He knew it was illegal. But setting up a false identity is very easy and very safe. He took my money, with all the taxes on it paid, so the IRS wouldn't get too interested, and invested it for Peter Stevens. He did it in 1950 and in 1951. Today, it amounts to $370,000 plus change. I guess my jaw made a thump when it dropped against my chest because he smiled. If I hadn't ended up here, I'd probably be worth $7 or $8 million by now, and probably an ulcer as big as a portable radio. His hands went into the dirt and began sifting out more pebbles. They moved gracefully, restlessly. The false name was just lugging the paintings out of the path of the hurricane. But I had no idea that the hurricane, that it could go on as long as it has. I didn't say anything for a while. I guess I was trying to absorb the idea that this small, spare man in prison gray next to me could be worth more money than Warden Norton could make the rest of his miserable life, even with the scams thrown in. For that kind of dough, you could have hired Clarence Darrow. Or whoever's passing for him these days, Christ. You could have been out of here like a rocket. He smiled. A good lawyer would have sprung the Williams kid from Cashman whether he wanted to go or not, I said. Why not, Andy? Well, because I outsmarted myself. If I ever tried to put my hand on Peter Stevens' money from inside here, I'd lose every cent of it. My friend Jim could have arranged it, but Jim's dead. You see the problem? Yeah, I saw it. For all the good the money could do Andy, it might as well have really belonged to another person. In a way, it did. If the stuff it was invested in turned bad, all Andy could do would be to watch it plunge and trace it day after day on the stocks and bonds page of the Press Herald. It's a tough life if you don't weaken, I guess. I'll tell you how it is, Red. There's a big hayfield near the town of Buxton. You know where Buxton is, don't you? I said I did. It lies right next door to Scarborough. And at the north end of this particular hayfield, there's a rock wall right out of a Robert Frost poem. And somewhere along the base of that wall is a rock that has no business in the main hayfield. It's a piece of volcanic glass, and until 1947, it was a paperweight on my office desk. My friend Jim put it in that wall. There's a key underneath it. The key opens a safe deposit box in the Portland branch of the Casco Bank. I guess you're in a pack of trouble, I said. When your friend Jim died, the IRS must have opened all his safety deposit boxes, along with the executor of his will, of course. Andy smiled and tapped the side of his head. Not bad. There's more up there than marshmallows, I guess. We took care of the possibility that Jim might die while I was in the slam. The box is in Peter Stevens' name. Once a year, the firm of lawyers that served Jim's executors sends a check to the Casco to cover the rental of the Stevens box. Peter Stevens is inside that box just waiting to get out. His birth certificate, his social security card, his driver's license. The license is 6 years out of date, but it's still perfectly renewable for a $5 fee. His stock certificates are there, his tax-free municipals, and about 18 bearer bonds in the amount of $10,000 each. I whistled. Told you this much, so I'll tell you something else, Red. For the last 20 years, give or take, I've been watching the papers for news of any contraction projects in Buxton. I keep thinking that someday soon I'm going to read that they're cutting a highway through there, or erecting a new community hospital, or building a shopping center, burying my new life under 10 feet of concrete. Jesus Christ, Andy. If all this is true, how do you keep from going crazy? He smiled. So far, all quiet on the Western Front. But it could be years. Maybe not as many as the state and Warden Norton think it should be. I just can't afford to wait that long. I keep thinking about Zihuatanejo and that small hotel. That's all I want for my life now, Red. And I don't think it's too much to want. I didn't kill Glenn Quentin. I didn't kill my wife. And that hotel is not too much to want. To swim and get a tan and sleep in a room with open windows and space. It's not too much to want. He slung the stones away. You know, Red, a place like that, I'd have to have a man who knows how to get things. The biggest drawback in my mind wasn't that we were talking pipe dreams in a shitty little prison exercise yard with armed guards looking down at us from sentry posts. I couldn't do that, I said. I couldn't get along on the outside. I'm what they call an institutional man now. In here, I'm the man who can get it for you. Yeah. But out there, anyone can get it for you. I wouldn't know how to begin or where. You underestimate yourself. You're a self-educated man, a self-made man, a rather remarkable man, I think. Hell, I don't even have a high school diploma. I know that, but it isn't just a piece of paper that makes a man. It isn't just prison that breaks one either. I couldn't hack it outside, Andy, I know that. He got up. You think it over, he said casually and strolled off, as if he was a free man who had just made another free man a proposition. And for a while, just that was enough to make me feel free. Andy could do that. He could make me forget for a time that we were at the mercy of a hard-ass parole board and a psalm-singing warden who liked Andy Dufresne right where he was. After all, Andy was a lapdog who could do tax returns. By that night in my cell, I felt like a prisoner again. The whole idea dragged at my brain like a fishhook. I fell asleep and dreamed of a great, glassy, black stone in the middle of a hayfield. I was trying to get the key that was underneath it. It wouldn't budge. It was too damn big. And in the background, getting closer, the baying of bloodhounds. Which leads us, I guess, to the subject of jailbreaks. Sure, they happen from time to time in our happy little family. You don't go over the wall, not if you're smart. Cons do go over, and the searchlights probing long white fingers across the fields that surround the prison almost always catch them. Anyhow, the day of that conversation about Mexico and Mr. Peter Stevens, that was the day I began to believe that Andy had some ideas of doing a disappearing act. I wouldn't have bet money on his chances of succeeding. Warden Norton, you see, was watching Andy with a special close eye. Andy wasn't just another deadhead with a number to Norton. They had a working relationship, you might say. Norton was watching. Andy knew it. And the screws knew it, too. And Andy was not the kind of man to try a casual type of escape. If I'd been him, the thought of that key would have tormented me endlessly. I would have been lucky to get 2 hours' worth of honest shut-eye a night. Buxton was less than 30 miles from Shawshank. So near, yet so far. The best chance was to engage a lawyer and try for retrial. Anything to get out from under Norton's thumb. Maybe Tommy Williams could be shut up by nothing more than a cushy furlough program, but I wasn't entirely sure. Williams had honestly liked Andy. Every now and then, I'd bring these points up to Andy. He'd smile, his eyes far away, and say he was thinking about it. In 1975, Andy Dufresne escaped from Shawshank. He hasn't been recaptured, and I don't think he ever will be. In fact, I don't think Andy Dufresne exists anymore. But I think there's a man in Zihuatanejo, Mexico, named Peter Stevens, probably running a new small hotel in this year of our Lord 1977. I'll tell you what I know and what I think. That's about all I can do, isn't it? On March the 12th, 1975, the cell doors in cell block 5 opened at 6:30 a.m. And as they do every day except Sunday, the inmates of those cells stepped forward in the corridor and formed two lines as the cell doors slammed behind them. At the main cell block gate, they were counted off by two guards before being sent down to the cafeteria for breakfast of oatmeal, scrambled eggs, and fatty bacon. All of this went off according to the routine until the count at the cell block gate. There should have been 29. Instead, there were 28. After a call to the captain of the guards, cell block 5 was allowed to go for breakfast. The captain of the guards, a not-half-bad fellow named Richard Garnier, and his assistant, Dave Burks, came down to cell block 5 right away. Garnier reopened the cell doors. He and Burks went down the corridor together, dragging their sticks over the bars, their guns out. In a case like that, what you usually have is someone who has been taken sick in the night. More rarely, someone had died or committed suicide. This time, they found a mystery. Instead of a sick or a dead man, they found no one. Gagne's first assumption was that there had been a miscount or a practical joke. So instead of going off to work after breakfast, the inmates of cell block 5 were sent back to their cells, joking and happy. Any break in the routine was always welcome. The cell doors opened. Prisoners stepped in. Cell doors closed. Some clown shouting, "I want my lawyer, I want my lawyer. You guys run this place like a friggin' prison." Burks, "Shut up in there or I'll rank you." The clown, "I ranked your wife, Berkey." Gagne and Burks went up the line, counting noses. They didn't have to go far. "Who belongs in this cell?" Gagne asked the right side night guard. "Andrew Dufresne," the right side answered. Everything stopped being routine right there. The balloon went up. In all prison movies I've seen, this wailing horn goes off when there's a break. Not at Shawshank. The first thing Gagne did was to get in touch with the warden. The second thing was to get the search of the prison going. The third was to alert the state police in Scarborough to the possibility of a breakout. That was routine. It didn't call for them to search the suspected escapee's cell, so no one did. Why would they? It was a case of what you see is what you get. It was a small, square room, bars on the window and bars on the sliding door. There was a toilet and an empty cot. Some pretty rocks still on the windowsill. And the poster, of course. It was Linda Ronstadt by then. The poster was right over his bunk. There had been a poster there in that exact same place for 26 years. And when someone, it was Warden Norton himself, poetic justice if there ever was any, looked behind it, they got one hell of a shock. That didn't happen until 6:30 that night, almost 12 hours after Andy had been reported missing. Probably 20 hours after he actually made his escape. Norton hit the roof.